Good morning to one all. Today we are going to discuss briefly about parameter estimation techniques. Let us go back to minimum error classifier. If you are having C class classification problem with L and the concerned prior probabilities are P of omega 1, P of omega 2 and so on up to P of omega C. Here the concerned prior probabilities and the concerned likelihood functions are fx bar of x bar after omega 1, fx bar of x bar after omega 2 and so on, fx bar of x bar after omega c. Here the concerned likelihood functions for those c classes, where x bar represents the input feature vector with dimension d cross 1. Then according to minimum error classifier, which is same as major a posteriori probability classifier, MAP classifier, I star equals to R max of P of omega j into fx bar of x bar after omega j, and the concerned omega I star is the MAP classifier output, is the optimal class we are going to get for the given input feature vector x bar. But in order to do this one, we need to know what is prior probability and what is the likelihood function for all these C classes. One approach to this problem is to use the training samples to estimate the unknown probabilities and probability densities and to use the resulting estimates as if they were the true values. Estimation of prior probabilities is very straightforward, that can be done so easily, but there is a difficulty in estimating the likelihood functions fx bar of x bar after omega j, where j from 1 to c. This is a bit difficult as compared to estimation of prior probabilities. As we already saw in the yesterday's class, estimation of a probability density function for a continuous random variable is not so easy, that's very difficult. We gone for that histogram approximation, right? It required more number of training samples to estimate continuous probability density functions. That's not so easy, right? It required huge amount of training data for that. In order to reduce the amount of training data required to compute these probability density functions, we can simply go for representation of that probability density function with the help of few number of parameters. If we are able to represent our probability density function with the help of some small number of parameters, if we are able to parameterize like that, then it's very easy for us to estimate that probability density function with the help of the moderate amount of training data. No need to go for very huge training data in order to estimate that PDF. Let's have a look into those techniques now. For example, one reasonable assumption for this likelihood function is, in general, that can be jointly Gaussian random variable, that x bar, that feature vector, whatever we are having, d cross 1 feature vector, it's having d random variables, right? That can be modeled as jointly Gaussian random variables. That can be modeled in that way. If we are able to represent that as a jointly Gaussian, then our target is we need to estimate the mean values of those samples and covariance matrix for that one. Once you know mean vector and covariance matrix, then we can represent that jointly Gaussian distribution with the help of mean vector and covariance matrix straight away, right? that is as follows. For example, if you are having some set of samples, here some set of samples which corresponds to omega 1 class. Each and every sample is some x bar with d cross 1 dimension. In that scenario, if you are modeling this class conditional distribution, for example class 1, omega 1, by using jointly Gaussian random variable, then that can be represented as follows. This is Gaussian or normal distribution with mean vector mu bar and covariance matrix sigma 1. Like this we can represent, where mu 1 bar is a d cross 1 mean vector, which is same as E of x bar when you know that is from class omega 1, E of x bar after omega 1, and sigma 1 equals to E of x bar minus mu 1 bar into x bar minus mu 1 bar transpose, and all these samples are from class 1, omega 1, right? Just for simplicity, if you want, you can remove this one, but you can remember that all these samples are from class omega 1. Similarly, you can remove this one and try to remember that all these x bar vectors are from class 1. This dimension is d cross 1, and the dimension of this one is d cross 1, the dimension of this one is 1 cross d, and effectively the dimension of this one is d cross d. See, d cross d is the dimension of this. But one thing we can observe here is this covariance matrix is symmetric. If you want, you can cross check this. Sigma 1 transpose equal to sigma 1, because we know sigma 1 equals to E of x bar minus mu 1 bar into x bar minus mu 1 bar transpose. I'm just removing this after knowing that there is from omega 1, that you can remember. And if I apply transpose both sides, sigma 1 transpose equals to expectation of, we know this, right? AB whole transpose equals to B transpose into A transpose. In this case, the whole transpose of this one is same as this one transpose into this one transpose. This part whole transpose is same as x bar minus mu 1, right? Once again, we are getting the same thing, into x bar minus mu 1 bar transpose, which is same as sigma 1, right? It is symmetric. So the number of parameters that we need to estimate here are mu bar contains d cross 1, right? D parameters from mean vector and from covariance matrix, we need to estimate d into d plus 1 by 2 parameters. If you want, you can cross check. If you are having covariance matrix like this, for example, let's have d equal to 3. See, 3 cross 3, right? For example, d equal to 3. In this case, this is sigma 1 square, this is sigma 2 square, this is sigma 3 square. And this will be sigma 1 2 square, this is sigma 1 3 square, this is sigma 2 3 square. This one corresponds to, due to symmetry, that is same as sigma 1 2 square. This corresponds to sigma 1 3 square. and due to symmetry, this corresponds to sigma 2 3 square. Sigma 3 2 square is same as sigma 2 3 square, both are same. And if you look into this one, this part is same as this part, right? If you know this one, you can find this. They are identical, right? One, this part is something different. Sigma 1 square, sigma 2 square, and sigma 3 square. If you are having three features in this, d equal to 3, right? Then these are the concerned variances for each features. This is variance for feature 1, variance for feature 2, variance for feature 3. In that particular feature vector, 3 cross 1 feature vector. And the total number of parameters that you need to estimate here are, you can see 3 plus 3, 6 parameters you need to estimate, right? If you want, you can cross check with this expression. 3 into 3 plus 1 means 4 divided by 2, which is same as 6, right? 6 parameters you need to estimate. It means the total number of parameters that you need to estimate in order to frame that giant probability density function fx bar of x bar after omega 1, this giant distribution, in order to find this, the number of parameters that you require are d plus d into d plus 1 by 2. These many number of parameters you need to estimate. For example, if input feature vector x bar is 100 cross 1, it means d equal to 100. In that scenario, the number of parameters that you need to estimate are d means 100 plus d into d plus 1 by 2, 100 into 101 divided by 2, that equals to 100 plus 50 into 101. It's roughly, okay, this is 5050 and 5150, right? 5150 parameters you need to estimate. Just 5150 parameters. Instead of this one, if you are trying to go for that partitioning with the help of histogram, you can imagine, it may require a very huge amount, right? If you are going for such partitioning, that's not so easy. We might have seen in the last class, like, it may require something of the order of 10 power 100 parameters, right? 10 power 100 parameters. That too, when we considered that range of x from 0 to 1, why is it Gaussian? Gaussian means that it will go from minus infinity to plus infinity. This quantity will be so high, the number of rectangle boxes that we are considering is not even 10, very big number compared to 10, whole power 100. That's so huge, right? Huge number of parameters. This will simplify our problem. Instead of going for so many parameters like this, we will simply go for estimation of 5150 parameters. Less number of parameters requires less number of training data. That's good for us, right? That's the benefit of parameterization. If you are able to represent your probability density function with the help of very small number of parameters, it's good for you. You can try to reduce the amount of training data required in order to find the giant probability density function for that. Most famous methods for this parameter estimation are marginal likelihood estimation and Bayesian estimation. Let's have a look into marginal likelihood estimation. Let us consider a set of training samples. The set is represented by D, capital D. The training data set, like that you can think, which are drawn independently from probability density function fx bar of x bar after theta to estimate the unknown parameter vector theta. This corresponds to actual probability density function from where we are randomly picking some samples and we formed that like a training data. For example, I will try to collect 1 million training samples, 1 million samples from this distribution, 1 million samples from this distribution, and I will try to call it like set D. D is that set, it's a training samples, 1 million training samples in this case. Now I want to estimate the concerned parameter theta in this probability density function with the help of this D, with the help of my training data. That's my target in this. Hey, theta is unknown for me. I want to estimate this theta with the help of this training samples. For example, D contains n samples x1 bar to xn bar. Here the feature vectors x1 bar, x2 bar and so on up to xn bar. Since the samples are drawn independently, we can simply multiply, right? We can simply multiply this one. We know this already, right? Suppose x1, x2 and so on up to xn are n random variables, then the joint probability density function fx bar of x1, x2 up to xn equals to fx1 of x1 into fx2 of x2 and so on up to fxn of xn, root of marginals when they are independent random variables, or if you draw them independently, like that you can write, right? We are doing the same thing here. We are drawing those samples independently from the distribution. Something similar to coin toss experiment, right? You are having some fair coin with you and you are tossing the coin three times, for example. Then all three are independent tosses, right? Then if I ask you the question like, what is the probability that all three will be head, then that is same as 1 by 2 into 1 by 2 into 1 by 2. Probability of first toss is head, probability of second toss is head, probability of third toss is head. When they are independent, you can multiply them, right? That's what we are doing here. The same thing. They are drawn independently from this distribution, and that can be written like this, right? Product of all those probability density functions. This can be called as likelihood function. If of d after theta is a function of theta, right? The maximum likelihood estimate of theta is the value of theta hat. Theta hat means estimation. The value of theta hat that maximizes if of d after theta. It's called as marginal likelihood estimation. We are calling it like a likelihood, right? We are trying to maximize this likelihood by adjusting this theta. That particular theta hat corresponds to marginal likelihood estimate of theta. Let's have a look into example of Gaussian. Gaussian case with unknown mean vector mu bar. See, giantly Gaussian. Giantly Gaussian means if you know mean vector and if you know that covariance matrix, we can define that entire giantly probability, giantly Gaussian probability density function, right? With the help of mean vector and covariance matrix. Here we consider that we already know the covariance matrix sigma. We already know this one. Only unknown thing in this case is mean vector, mu bar. We need to estimate mu bar. And this likelihood function f of d after theta equals to pi k equal to 1 to n f x of x bar sk bar after theta equals to, see, giantly Gaussian, right? That's why I have written like this. So giantly Gaussian distribution. And maximization of f of d after theta is same as maximization of ln f of d after theta. Ln corresponds to natural logarithm. Because see, if this is increasing, this will also increase, right? Ln of this. If x is increasing, ln x also will increase. That's why maximization of this one is same as maximization of this one. We are going to get the maximum value for this and for this at the same point theta hat. At same theta hat, we are going to get maximum for this and maximum for this also, right? Because this is increasing with respect to this. See logarithm for that expression, for this expression. And if you equate the first derivative, this corresponds to first derivative, gradient operation, dou by dou theta 1, dou by dou theta 2, and so on up to dou by dou theta d. Here theta corresponds to mu bar. Mu bar is the unknown thing, right? Theta is the unknown parameter, mu bar. Say mu 1, mu 2, up to mu d. Mean vector is d cross 1, right? Because mu bar equals to E of x bar, where x bar is d cross 1 feature vector. See del mu, dou by dou mu 1, dou by dou mu 2, and so on dou by dou mu d. You are equating these partial derivatives to zeros. A zero vector, d cross 1 zero vector. From this, you can try to have mu bar hat as, this is the estimation, hat means estimation, equals to 1 by n sigma k equal to 1 to n xk bar, which is same as sample mean. This is sample mean, right? We are simply going for average of all these n samples, n training samples. This is called as sample mean. Whatever the estimated mean that we got with the help of maximum likelihood estimation is same as sample mean. Let's go for the second case where along with mean vector, covariance matrix also unknown. In this case, we need to estimate both mean vector and covariance matrix. Let's consider once again this likelihood function f of d after theta. D corresponds to our training examples or training set, that n training samples are there, right? X1 bar, x2 bar, and so on up to xn bar. Here theta corresponds to mu bar and sigma. And once again, if you apply maximum likelihood estimation, see dou by dou mu 1, dou by dou mu 2, and so on dou by dou mu d, and dou by dou sigma 1 square, dou by dou sigma 2 square, dou by dou sigma d square, and dou by dou sigma 1 2 square, and so on. If you are equating those partial derivatives to 0, and if you try to simplify them, we are going to end up with these expressions. The estimated mean vector is same as once again sample mean. Sample mean of all those n training examples. And this sigma hat estimated covariance matrix is same as sample covariance. We can see this one. It is something similar to expectation of x minus mu bar into x minus mu bar transpose, right? If you convert that into sample mean, that will be 1 by n into the sum of all these things, right? The sample covariance matrix, similar to that one, right? Let's go to Bayesian parameter estimation. Here the form of density function is assumed to be known. something similar to our marginal likelihood estimation, right? There also we assume that the density function is known for us, the form of the density function, but not theta. If x bar of x bar after theta is known for us, like earlier we assume that might follow jointly Gaussian distribution, that form we know, but we don't know the parameters. That theta is unknown for us, that mu bar or that sigma is unknown for us. Similarly, here also we will try to assume that model is known for us. For example, Gaussian, that might be Gaussian, but that parameters are unknown for us. Earlier, we don't have any other awareness about this unknown theta, but in this scenario, we'll try to have some initial guess about theta. In marginal likelihood estimation, if theta is unknown, that's unknown. We don't have any extra information about theta. But in our Bayesian parameter estimation case, we'll try to have some assumptions about theta, that unknown theta. Like this theta might follow some probability density function f theta of theta. Some prior density about theta. This might follow this prior density function f theta of theta. The rest of our knowledge about theta is contained in a set D of n training samples drawn independently according to unknown probability density f x bar of x bar. We don't know exact theta, right? Only thing we know is theta might follow some distribution. Up to that we know, but we don't know what is the exact value for that parameter, unknown parameter theta. That exact value we'll try to estimate with the help of this known training set. We have n training samples, right? With the help of the training samples, we want to modify this prior density function. That means our ultimate goal is we need to estimate f theta of theta after d. This is before knowing training samples d, that n training samples is a distribution of theta. This is after knowing n training samples, what happens to the distribution of theta that corresponds to this one. Our goal is we need to estimate this one. Once we estimated this one, our PDF we are going to get is as follows. X bar of x bar after knowing d equals to integral f x bar after theta into f theta after d theta. In this way, we can try to find this likelihood function. This is a likelihood function we are going to estimate with the help of n training samples. This is a final thing. We are trying to average over all theta, right? It's something like averaging these distributions with respect to all possible thetas. F theta of theta after d theta. It's some sort of averaging, right? We are trying to averaging over multiple models. Each theta corresponds to one model. For example, like f x bar after theta 1 is one model, after theta 2 is another model. We are multiplying them with these probability density function values, some sort of weighted averaging of those models. It means for Bayesian case, we are trying to consider some set of models indirectly. And finally, we are trying to take the average value from all those models. That's what we are doing here. But for marginal likelihood scenario, we don't have multiple models. We have only one model. We are estimating that parameter theta. After estimating that parameter theta, the theta is deterministic. And we have only one model. But in this case, the final theta we are going to get is not deterministic. That's also probabilistic in nature. I will try to take some set of theta values with certain probability density function. Now we'll try to average these models with respect to all thetas. For each theta there is some model. For example, for theta 1, f x bar of x bar after theta 1. For theta 10, that f x bar of x bar after theta 10. That theta 1, theta 2, theta 10 and so on. They are from this distribution. And as you know, Bayes formula as follows. This is a Bayes formula. From here, we can estimate this a posteriori probability of theta after knowing this training data set. And as usual, by independence assumption, f of d after theta is product of these things. For example, consider jointly Gaussian case with known covariance matrix and unknown mean vector. And this is a prior distribution about mean vector, Gaussian with mu naught bar and covariance matrix sigma naught. It's a prior distribution. Our first target is we need to estimate what is f of mu bar after d, after knowing the training sample. It should be modified, right? Once you know the training data. And if you apply this, we are going to end up with this solution. Mu n bar equals to this one and sigma n equal to this expression. They are big expressions, right? And once you got this one, once you got f of mu bar after d, see, this we found with the help of this expression. Bayes formula is there, right? In this case, theta is nothing but mu bar. Theta is mu bar. If you do this simplification, we are going to end up with this expression. This will be once again Gaussian. We started with Gaussian prior. Once again, we ended with Gaussian only. See, a posteriori probability, once you know that training data. This is once again Gaussian with mean vector mu n bar and variance and the covariance matrix sigma n. Instead of sigma naught, this is sigma n. Instead of mu naught bar, this is mu n bar. And once we know this a posteriori probability for this unknown parameter vector mu bar, then we can compute this one. If x bar after d with the help of this expression, integral f x bar after mu bar into f mu bar after d into d mu bar. And if you try to simplify that one, we are going to end up with this expression. This also Gaussian with mean vector mu n bar and covariance matrix sigma plus sigma n is the final result we are going to get. This is a class likelihood function. Likelihood function for the given class. Thank you.